Hi, hello, my name is Allie and this is my channel where I talk about what I'm knitting, how it's going, and what it's costing me. I'm a graphic designer coming to you from just outside Toronto, and today we're going to be getting into a finished object. If you've noticed what I'm wearing, we're also going to talk about my whip that I have going on, as well as some yarn acquisitions, and then as always we're going to get into some non-knitting, reading, other creative stuff at the end. As for what I'm drinking today, we have a slight change of pace on the mug front in that it is not a mug, but it is still artisan made ceramics in this super cute cup that I got for my birthday that is actually made by someone who I went to OCAD with. Her name is Heidi Burton. She's an illustrator who has recently started branching out into illustrated ceramics, and it's just so cute with the little straw in the fold. And so in honor of being a cup today, I am drinking iced tea because I didn't wish to scald my esophagus by trying to drink hot tea with a straw, but that's a lot of change. So we couldn't veer too far in terms of the actual tea. So as always, drinking Earl Grey, but again, we have variety this week because I'm drinking Trader Joe's Earl Grey. And if you're thinking how you're in Canada, I went to Pittsburgh last weekend for a wedding and went to go visit Trader Joe's. I had never been before, despite the fact that I've been to the States several times. And it seemed like a thing I had to go check out, in no small part because I was told and kind of forcibly dragged by the people I was with that it was somewhere I had to go check out. Plus also, this just kind of tied in a funny way to my work as a graphic designer, because I have a client who kind of perpetually references Trader Joe's in our discussions about branding and product packaging. So you know what? It was work research. And like, I was a fan of Trader Joe's. It was a great time. There were lots of good snacks to be had. But I don't feel like their Earl Grey tea tastes like an Earl Grey. Am I alone in this? If you've had the Trader Joe's Earl Grey, let me know your thoughts, because I feel like I am not tasting the Earl. I don't know. It just tastes like a random black tea, but it's fine. It's not bad black tea. It just doesn't taste like Earl Grey. Anyway, that's what we're drinking today out of our super cute cup. I will also pop a link to Heidi's shop down below. Okay, let's start with finished objects since I'm wearing one. So this is the Fausta Bralette by lowkey.bold.knit. I cast this on July 21st and I finished this about a week ago at the very end of August. So this is a pattern that's designed to fit up to a 56 inch bust, which I would love to see go a bit further. But a really cool thing that this pattern does is that you actually measure separately for your bust and your underbust. And the pattern has specific measurements to knit a busted at the gust that corresponds to the difference between those measurements. So it's actually much more customized in fit than your average pattern, which is really, really cool. And I feel like you can really see, like, I'll stand up and show you this top in a minute. So I was knitting the size 1A, one for the underbust and A for the bust. And I feel like it just fits like flawlessly. Like, I love it. I'm so impressed with how the sizing for this pattern works. Just so good. And in terms of cost, this pattern was €7 or about $11 Canadian. So this is the Fausta Bralette pattern by lowkey.bold.knit, which I actually modified to be a full length top. So let me get up and show you what this looks like. Okay, here it is. Here is my finished Fausta top. This is obviously a tucked into high-waisted pants, so there is more top than you can see here. I'll show you in a second it untucked so you can see the actual length, but I just love this top. Like, it fits so well. The custom gusset sizing, the way that you do separate measurements for your bust and your underbust, it just worked out like flawlessly in this pattern. I'm really impressed with it. I feel like it looks so like elegant. I love the super square wide neck. I wore this out to a dinner when we were in Pittsburgh. I feel like it's just at that perfect intersection of so cute but doesn't look like you tried very hard. it's so good. Also show how it looks layered. So if I pop on my no frills cardigan, because the straps are set so wide, when you have a cardigan over it, it functions as sort of like a tube tuck. You just get this perfect straight across neckline, and it works super well as sort of like a shell underlayer. So in terms of the actual length, I will untuck it to show you. So it actually comes down to about there. This is really the only part that I would do differently if I were to do this again. I think that I would make this longer, because I think that if I were trying to actually wear it like this with lower waisted pants, I do think I would get some like riding up and kind of be pulling it down a decent amount to keep it there, just because it doesn't go far enough past the widest part of my hips to kind of start to settle on them well, if that makes sense. But this is my modified Fausta Bralette into the Fausta top. So I knit this out of La Bien-Aimée Felix in the color Winterfell Held Double, which is a very beautiful yarn. It's also a very expensive yarn. It's a blend of 75% Falkland Merino and 25% Corriedale. And to knit this, I used two skeins, but I only had to buy one because one of them was gifted to me by my friend Amy when she was doing a de-stash. But that one single skein I had to buy cost me $65 Canadian, including shipping. So I would not have been knitting this out of this material if I did not already have one skein for free. I will be clear about that. I'm absolutely in love with this color, but I don't think that I ever could have justified like a $140 tank top to myself. But yes, yeah, so I ordered one skein and I ordered it from the Knitting Loft in Toronto. And that cost included about $11 of shipping. So all in with the materials and the pattern cost, this cost me about $75 Canadian or about $55 US, which still on the expensive end for a tank top, but feels a lot better to me than double that would have. But I'm so lucky that Amy gave me this destash yarn because I just love the color of it so much. It is just, to me, the absolute perfect, like, deep peacocky blue. The greeny tones in it just make it, like, absolutely perfect to me. I love it. Now, this pattern is written for 3mm needles, but because I knit tight, I knit this on a 3.25mm to meet gauge. And I think my row height might have ended up being, like, a little bit short still. I'm not entirely sure, but that does tend to happen to me. So this top is knit from the bottom up, which if you've been here a while, you will know that I've been talking about knitting this top for a very, very, very long time. And part of the reason that it took me so long to get around to it is because it's knit from the bottom up and that I wanted to lengthen it, which was a complicating factor because as part of lengthening it, I wanted to do waist shaping. So I'll stand up to show you quickly. You can see here at the bottom, I cast on with more stitches than the pattern has written in for the waist area. Cast on with more stitches to do these tidy 2x2 rib decreases to get down to the number of stitches written in the pattern for the waist. And I talked a lot more about how I did that in the last couple of podcast episodes where I've talked about this top. So I will link those up here, one after the other, and both in the description box below. But the short version is that to do that required a lot of math. It was just a very long, like, multi-step calculation thing. And I just avoided doing it for a really long time. But now that it's done, I'm so happy that I did because I absolutely love the way that this fits. I feel like the only thing that could have made this a better fit were if it were a little bit longer, like I said before, which is a little bit frustrating because I did try so hard to avoid that by doing, I did several mid-project blocks to check how my length was going as I went. I also tried it on several times because one of the big things that I find in knitting with rib is that because rib is designed to stretch this way, when you stretch this way, things shrink this way. So I did keep thinking, oh my God, look how much length I have. And then I put it on and it would only be like this long. So I tried so hard to get the length of this quite right. But I think in the end, what got me is that I just overestimated how tall the actual bust gusset part of the top was gonna be. Like, I think I just thought that it was going to sit a little bit differently than it actually does. So if I had known that, if I were knitting this again, I would just have knit a little bit more body before I started doing the bust gusset. But considering that I currently plan to wear this tucked in basically all the time anyway, that's kind of a non-issue. And if at some point I start trying to wear this untucked with lower rise pants, do I have it in me to go back to lower rise pants? I don't know, but I would like to give myself options. So in that event, I might start to notice more the lack of length, but I think that it's still enough that it still looks good. I might just have to do like a little bit more adjusting once in a while than I would ideally like to, but I think that it's still so good. And like overall, like my impression of this finished object and how I feel about it in my wardrobe, like 10 out of 10. I'm so excited about this one. And I'm really sad that like summer is basically over. I don't think I'm gonna get to wear it a lot more this summer. But like I showed, it does look really good under a cardigan. So maybe it will still get some use in the transitional seasons. And I'm gonna be so excited to pull it out next summer. Now, this project has been sort of a funny one to work on because like I said, there was that big hurdle up front of having to do all these calculations to figure out even how many stitches do I need to cast on with. But then it was really very smooth sailing from that point. I had to pause to do some mid-project blocks and some try-ons, but there was no difficulty. It was just these sort of like menial little admin things that had to happen along the way. But it was very smooth until like the very end. But I was at the point where I was about to knit the straps off of the front. And I was like, okay, this seems like, you know, I should probably try this on to make sure that all is well now before I knit all of these straps. And I couldn't get it on, which had not been a problem the entire rest of the time. I had tried this on several times throughout the process. But what you do with this pattern is first you cast off the back. And then you finish doing your gusset. I think about half of the gusset happens after you've already cast off the back. And then you cast off all of the front except for where you're gonna do the straps. And in the pattern, it tells you to switch to a smaller size needle, which I do not have. I was already knitting this on the smallest needle in my set. But I was like, okay, well, I can't do that. But you know what? I'm a tight knitter and it's supposed to be on small needles. So if I just take care to bind off extra tight, that's probably perfect, right? That's probably all that I need to do. So that's what I did. The pattern just calls for a standard bind off where you slip one stitch over the other stitch. But it was way too tight. Like not only was it not allowing the ribbing to stretch out, but it was actually kind of pulling the ribbing a little bit in and just had absolutely no give to it whatsoever. And I was like, oh no, because again, like I said, you bind the back off a good while before you bind the front off. So to fix the back, would mean undoing a bunch of the gusset. And I was like, oh no. So at first I was like, okay, maybe I can just redo the front bind off and just do it just a little bit looser. Just do the standard bind off, but don't try to make it tight. Try to make it loose. And maybe that'll make a big enough difference that you can get it on. Because the way it initially was, like I tried to pull it over my head and I could not get it over my shoulders. Like that was the issue. It was just not giving enough stretch to get over this widest part. And so I redid the front and it was a struggle. I got into it, but it was like, it felt like I needed to be dressed by my like Victorian ladies in waiting while I just go like this and they like pull it out down over, you know, like and I didn't have Victorian ladies in waiting. So I was just there like wrestling in my bathroom, like trying to get into this without ripping something, and like got in, but by like the skin of my teeth. And then I was looking at it in the mirror, and because the stretch was happening more in the front than in the back, what it meant was that the tight back was sort of cinching everything back further so that the gusset of the top wasn't even actually sitting like at the bust. It was just sitting like entirely like on the side of my body, more toward the back. And it was just like, that's just not where this is supposed to sit. So like, not only was it a battle and a half to get it on and off, but it was also just like not looking right. So I was like, okay, I can't fix this just by fixing the front of this garment. I need to rip back. So I ripped back until the part where the back was unbound as well. I said goodbye to my half gusset. It's not that it was actually a ton of knitting, but it's just that I was so close to being done, right? Like I was like, all I have to do is the straps. And I was like, just kidding. We hit a brick wall. So I had done my initial bind off, ripped it out, rebound the front, ripped that off, ripped all the way back to rip the back out. And then what I ultimately decided to do, I was like, okay, I could just try to do that loose standard bind off again, but I wasn't entirely convinced that it was going to be enough stretch even still to land the way that it really should. And I was surprised because I went looking at Ravelry, you know, enough other people have knit this that I was like, okay, surely someone will have some like wisdom for me on this, right? Did someone else run into this problem? What did they do to resolve it? Am I doing something weird? Like, have I misunderstood something? And I looked at so many projects with so many notes and just like almost none of them referenced this. I think I found maybe one who said that they had this problem where they couldn't remotely get it on. So I don't know if just I do something especially wildly tight when I do a standard bind off or what was going on, but it just left me feeling like I don't feel confident that I can just do a looser standard bind off and have this fit properly. And I don't want to find that out by again knitting the entire rest of this gusset and then having to rip all of that out again to get all the way down to the back. So what I actually decided to do instead was a sewn bind off. And I landed on this because I think I actually tested this on a swatch maybe. I honestly don't remember if I did at this point. It sounds like a responsible thing to do, but I feel like I'm a person who is responsible in all ways except maybe in my hobbies. I don't feel like I really apply that to knitting. So I'm not sure that I did that. Oh no, I didn't. Cause you know what I did? I went and I looked at a bunch of my other knits that I had done the tubular bind off on, and I was trying to compare it to the standard bind off. I was just kind of looking at these and seeing like, okay, if my ribbing is here and I'm doing the stretch on a sewn bind off, how much is it letting that ribbing flare out versus how much is ribbing on a standard bind off that I've done? How much is that allowing the ribbing to flare out? So I was kind of doing these little tests and concluded that the sewn bind off does give quite a bit more stretch than the standard bind off, but it also does such a nice job. One of the things I love about the sewn bind off is that it really still holds its shape, unlike some other stretchy, even stretchier bind offs that actually allow so much stretch that the fabric starts to flare, right? And you kind of lose the crisp structural integrity of that edge. So I was like, okay, I think maybe a sewn bind off might be the sort of Goldilocks in between, stretchy enough, but not too stretchy to make this project work. Now, the one tricky part with this is that this is a 2x2 rib, and I've only ever done a sewn bind off on a 1x1 rib. I know that there is a thing, I think this is popular in Andrea Mowry patterns especially, where you do the sewn bind off on the 2x2 by first rearranging your stitches into a 1x1 rib in order to then do the 1x1 sewn bind off, which I've never done before. I've done some patterns that call for the sewn bind off on a 2x2 by rearranging, and it just kind of seemed weird to me because I was like, well, but it's not gonna look in pattern, and that just seems like a lot of work for it to not look perfect. And to me, like, so much of the appeal of the sewn bind off is the sort of pristine perfection of that invisible edge. So I was kind of like, well, what's the point? And where that had come up for me before, I just ended up doing the standard bind off because it worked well in that situation. But here I was like, okay, well, maybe this is when I do it, and especially because obviously the standard bind off that was called for in the pattern wasn't going to be invisible. This doesn't need to be invisible. It's fine that it's going to kind of be rearranging the stitches and not be perfectly in pattern. And maybe this is the time that I try that. Now, did that stop me from first researching, like, is there a way to actually do an actual 2x2 sewn bind off? And it's funny because when you try to search for that, 99% of what you find is like, yeah, there is. You rearrange the stitches into 1x1 and it like purports to be a 2x2 sewn bind off, but is actually just the same 1x1 sewn bind off after you've rearranged. But I did find one. I found one tutorial that was like, this is how you actually do an actual 2x2 sewn bind off. And I was like, aha, here it is. This is what I will do. And then I watched the video and I was like, and because I don't know about you, but the first time that I watched the sewn bind off tutorial, that was kind of my reaction, right? But after doing it, you know, just one or two repetitions of it, I was like, oh no, okay, I understand the rhythm. This makes sense. This one was just like so many more steps. And my fear, like, it's not that I didn't think I could follow those steps, but my fear was that I was going to be doing enough of this that inevitably when I'm doing a sewn bind off, I at some point kind of mentally check out and lose where I am and then have to look at it and like figure out what I need to do next. And the steps of the 2x2 were just in such a way that I didn't have faith that I would be able to lose my place and find it again, just because there were so many different things kind of happening simultaneously that were different at parts that kind of looked the same on the fabric, and you just kind of had to know where you were. And I will pop a link to that in the description in case you feel more up to this than I did at the time. And I'm also not saying that I'm never gonna try this. I could definitely see myself attempting this at some point, particularly if it were like a sweater with a 2x2 cuff and I could start with just a cuff. I know that I can probably retain my focus long enough to get through just a small cuff and then see how that goes. But I just didn't have a lot of faith in me doing that for the length of the bind off for this entire top. So that felt overly ambitious. Again, the pattern only called for a standard bind off. So I was like, you know what? I feel like the 1x1 will look just fine. And I feel like it looks just fine, more than fine. I feel like it looks great. I feel like it actually looks better than it did with a standard bind off. And it's such a nice combination of like stretchy enough to put it on very, very easily and very comfortably, but still holds its shape once it's on you well enough that it doesn't feel at all like it's going to gape open. It feels nice and secure all the way around. So I feel like this was the perfect bind off solution for my particular tension issues. I guess I'm so confused how no one else had this problem, but that's fine. I figured it out. I also had to do a little bit more unraveling once I knit the straps, because I knew that I was sort of going to be estimating the appropriate length, right? So I kind of took a measurement of like, okay, what do I think would be like slightly longer than I need so that I know that I have enough and then I can sort of rip back as needed to where I actually want to sew this onto the back. When I did that, when I actually went to sew it, I ended up unraveling like probably like close to 6 inches, because what I realized was that measurement was like an unstretched strap. And what I realized is that in order for this top to feel secure, like it's actually holding it up and these straps aren't just sort of dangling there ready to fall off at any moment, and the fact that this is wool and wool stretches, I was going to want to be sort of stretching the straps while taking that measurement, right? It was going to want to be sort of stretching over my shoulder with some tension when it was attached. So once I had it entirely on my body with the straps and was sort of pulling it back here to where it felt like the right sort of tension and security, and then I pinned it to the back of the top, there was a lot left over. So I did remove that last little bit. And then the pattern tells you to just sew on the end of the strap to the back of the top. But I always feel kind of like lost about how to do sewing on knits like this in things that are kind of important for structural integrity, right? Like the straps are kind of important. So what I actually decided to do was just pick up some stitches along the back where I wanted to attach it. And then I did a 3-needle bind off to attach them so that I knew that it was really secure and I like understood how it was secure. And then when I did that, it did kind of leave just sort of like a little bit of each side of the strap, just sort of that like half stitch. Didn't really have anything grounding it to the back. So I then just did like a little bit of sewing to sort of trap those very corners of the straps down to the fabric to give it that nice sort of like perfect right angle join. But the 3-needle bind off is sort of the crux of the adhesion there. Oh, I will also say in terms of the length, there was something sort of deceptive to me about this project in terms of my yarn, because as I was knitting up toward the bust gusset, before it started the bust gusset, I was looking at my ball of yarn going, I feel like I'm running out of this quickly. I feel like this ball is getting very small, considering that I've not yet knit anything that's going to cover up here, which is kind of the most important part for a top to cover. And I was like, am I gonna run out of this? So I was getting a little bit nervous that I was running out of yarn. And then as it turned out, The gusset used so little yarn, like in part because you bind off the back before you bind off the front, so you end up knitting only this front panel. It used so little yarn. So if I had known that, I might have kept knitting longer before starting the gusset. I think I was at a point where it was sort of like, okay, like I feel like this is long enough. Like maybe it would be nicer if it was a little bit longer, but I think it's definitely long enough. And I think now it's a little bit short of definitely long enough. So it turned out a little bit shorter than I thought, but what I thought was still, I think, a little bit shorter than what would have been actually ideal. But I was like, am I running out of yarn? I don't want to run out of yarn. So had I known that, that might have also helped with my length issue a bit. Cause yeah, I now have a decent chunk of this yarn left over. And I'm like, what, how did this happen? I thought I was running out and now there's so much. All right, so that's it for my Fausta top. Okay, so let's talk whips. Now, has this one even been on the channel? I don't think so. I think I mentioned in my fall knitting plans that I had cast this on, but because I was filming that in lieu of a regular podcast video, it's actually been 4 weeks since I last recorded a podcast episode rather than the usual two, and a lot has happened. So here is not even just the beginning, but quite a lot of, at least half of, based on the fact that I've now used up half of my balls of the white yarn, so hopefully half of, a Sailor Swift Top by Veronica Lindberg. So let's go over some pattern stats. This pattern costs 590 euros, but I actually got it half off because at the time that I got it, there was a discount code happening for AKA Nora Knits 10K subscriber channel celebration. So cut in half and then converted to Canadian, this actually only cost me $4.40 Canadian. So this pattern accommodates up to a 59.5 inch bust, and sizing wise, I am knitting a kind of weird, sort of accidental Frankenstein of a small and an extra small. So I'll kind of explain as we get more into the process and how it's gone so far, but yeah. And as for materials, I'm knitting this out of the, oh, there's so much hair on this. One moment, please. So I'm knitting this out of the Knitting for Olive Pure Silk in the colors Putty, which I had to buy two balls of, and Brown Bear, which I had to buy one. So I ordered this online from Fia Fia, which is a Canadian yarn store. And that cost was $50.68. So by the time we add in the pattern cost, that brings our total project cost to about $55 Canadian or about $40 US. Now this pattern calls for a 3mm needle, which I do not actually have. I have my Luca needle set, which starts at a 3.25, but honestly, this has never been a problem for me because I knit tight and have to size up my needles all the time anyway. So in swatching for this, I decided to swatch on the 3.25, and also suspecting that that might still not be enough for me to hit gauge, I also swatched on the 3.5. I just kind of divided my swatch in half. And I found in doing that that neither option was really ideal because the 3.5 was getting me gauge, or at least very, very close to it, but it looked too open to me. I felt like the 3.25 looked like a much nicer fabric, and also knowing that this top is built to have a few inches of negative ease, so the fabric will be stretched, I really didn't want to be starting with a fabric that already looked more open than I wanted it to when it was just sitting in a relaxed way. So I was like, okay, it's not ideal. This is a pattern that talks about different options for fibers that you can use. I think some of the samples are knit in wool, some of them are knit in silk or cotton. And it does also mention that the weight of your yarn can vary a little. I think anywhere from a fingering to a DK is marked as acceptable. And she just mentions that it will just affect the drape of it. So the Knitting for Olive Pure Silk is, I believe, a fingering weight, but I liked the idea of this being a really sort of drapey, comfy top. But I think that in doing my swatch and realizing that this combined with the fact that I knit tight, this combination of factors is maybe not ideal for me for this pattern specifically, because I cannot seem to get this to match the gauge without upping needle size, looking more open than I want it to. So this is how we sort of got to a Franken size. So what I decided to do was just to knit the small instead of the extra small, which had been my original plan. And I was less worried about the stitch gauge. It wasn't too far off, but I was more worried about the row gauge, particularly as it affects the underarm depth. So that was what made me want to size up. But somewhere along knitting, I think I like forgot that I was doing that. So the way that you knit this is you start by casting on the back panel, and then you pick up to knit the front panel, and then you join in the round. So I cast on the back panel for the size small, but by the time I got to the front panel, and you start just by picking up here, so you're knitting just these two very narrow parts that you then join, I forgot that I was supposed to be looking at the second number of stitches in the list of instructions and not the first one. So my back is the width of a small. My straps are the width of the extra small. The straps get slightly wider in the small. But then I was like, oh no, I still need this to fit. So the way that I compensated for my straps when I ultimately joined the two halves of the front was that I cast on a few more neck stitches. So What this is going to mean is that mine is going to have a slightly wider neck than the pattern is written to, which may also mean that it looks like a bit more of a square neck than a round neck. I kind of won't really know that for sure until I have the I-cord on it, because there's not a lot of sort of rounding effect going on here. You do have this strap increasing out a little toward the bottom, so that does create a little bit of a sense of roundedness, but then all of this is just a straight line. So this may end up being more square necked, but also I love a square neck, so I'm not mad about that. That's fine. But just for reference in terms of sizing and proportions of straps and neckline, just know that that's going on here. So I cast this on August 18th, and like I said, we have about half of a tank top. So in terms of working with this yarn, besides the fact that I was struggling to meet gauge, things I have found about working with the pure silk so far. One is that it is definitely not very forgiving of tension issues. Let me see if I can find... I feel like I can see them all the time when I'm knitting, but of course now that I'm looking for one, I can't. I guess that's a good sign, but just little things. Like, I just feel like here you can see like a little bit of laddering between those two stitches in a way that I would never see something like that in a wool piece. This is my first time knitting with silk at all, not just specifically this knitting for all of one. And also I think my first time knitting with a non wool. Is that true? Yeah, I've never knit with cotton either or anything like that. So in that way, this is a different knitting experience. It's definitely less forgiving of tension issues, but I was kind of braced to dislike it more. I feel like a lot of people talk about finding, I was gonna say non-animal fiber, but I feel like silk kind of exists in a weird, like it does come from a creature. Is that creature an animal? Is a silkworm an animal? Is it a bug? Is a bug an animal? This... We don't have time for them. But it's not a plant-based fiber, right? Silkworm's not a plant. I don't know. But I feel like often I hear people talk about non-woolly animal fibers being much less comfortable to work with, being really hard on the hands, them wanting to have other projects to switch back and forth between. And that was something that I was kind of prepared for with this. But I actually found that to be a complete non-issue. I mean, is it as soft as wool? Definitely not. Does it have the nice bouncy stretch of wool on your hands? Absolutely not. But I also haven't found it to be an issue, other than a problem has returned that I haven't had since sort of last winter, but I have had before, which is sometimes when I'm knitting specific things, I will get a lot of dryness on my left hand index finger. The finger that I use to sort of like poke the tip of the needle to like get it to like go where it wants to go sometimes when things aren't just like flying off the needle super effortlessly on their own. I don't know, this is probably bad knitting form, but I often poke my needle tips with my left index finger. And once in a while, I end up on a project where my finger ends up being really dry and I get a bit of a crack in the skin. And then once in a while, the needle stabs directly into that crack. It just lands at the exact right slash wrong angle once in a while and like stabs down into like multiple layers of my skin. And it's terrible. And that did start happening with this. So I wonder if partly that is the sort of dryness, roughness of this material. But also the last time it was happening to me, I was knitting with the Knitting for Olive Merino and Silk Mohair. So I was working with a much softer knit, but maybe it was the silk strand, like the silk core of that mohair. Maybe that's what creates this dryness in my fingers. I don't know. I just know that when this happens, I either need to start knitting more carefully and just paying more attention to which part of my index finger touches the needle, or putting a band-aid over my finger while I'm working on it. But so that might be a thing. Also, I should probably just like moisturize my hands more, but I'm really bad at that. So that is a thing that I noticed. I've also noticed that I think a sort of byproduct of this not being stretchy in the way that wool is stretchy is that I think because I knit tight, so I think I do put a decent amount of tension on it while I'm working with it, where the wool would just stretch, because it doesn't have a lot of stretch, it kind of twists on itself, like kind of like when you're like putting ribbon on a present and you kind of like run the ribbon along a pair of scissors and like it suddenly coils. Like it kind of seems to be doing that. So I feel like I've been finding myself doing an unusual amount of untangling between my two balls, because I always have the putty and the round bear kind of going at the same time, right? Because I'm going back and forth between stripes. And these two balls are really tangling around each other, and not just in the way where every time I switch colors, it's adding one twist between the colors. It's actually that like one of these sort of gets coiled up in this ribbony way and ends up incidentally coiling around the other one. It has just been creating more tangles than I'm used to dealing with. Asterisk when I'm not doing intarsia, because when I'm doing intarsia, it's always a disaster. The poppins are always everywhere. Everything's always a mess. But I was not anticipating that in this project to such a degree, and that has really been a thing. I've definitely been doing more untangling. So I think that this is probably again caused by my tight tension. So if you are not like that, you probably won't have this issue with the silk, but that's just something I found with the silk as a tight knitter. For me, it's definitely not a reason that I wouldn't use this again. It is not at all happening to a degree that I'm like, oh my God, this is terrible, never again. It's just like, is it my favorite part when I have to pause and untangle? No. Would I happily do it again for the right garment? Absolutely. Now, in terms of the stripes, this is my first time ever knitting stripes. So this was really exciting to cast on and start out with. And at the very beginning, when I was just knitting the back, it absolutely was addictive. It was like, oh my God, I just wanna finish this stripe, wanna get to the next stripe, wanna get to the next stripe. But I have found that to become less motivating once I joined in the round, because just now it takes so much longer to complete a stripe that it's like, in one sitting, I might be lucky to get through an entire white stripe. Whereas when I was doing this, it was like, it was very fast. I was getting to do new stripes all the time. So it definitely has less of a fast paced popcorn knitting kind of feel now that I'm working in the round, but I am still really loving watching it knit up. And it is kind of nice to be able to gauge your progress in a much more concrete way, right? To be like, oh my God, this weekend I did 5 stripes, right? It's just, it's much easier to see how much you've done. And I think it just looks really good. Like, look at those stripes. That's so fun. I was knitting this at a family dinner the other day and my mom was like, oh, what a cute little like sailor top you're making. And I was like, funny you call it that because this is called the Sailor Swift top. So it definitely succeeds in giving the sailor vibes. 100%. And I want to show you one other funny kind of like, not problem, but just strange thing that happened to me because I did a silly thing. Is so because these stripes are relatively short, Veronica Lindberg recommends that you just carry the yarn up the side rather than cutting and having ends to weave in each time the color changes. So you just carry it up the side, but you'll see that in mine, that line is not, it's not straight. Now let me explain to you what happened. So when I joined this in the round, very shortly after I joined in the round, I at some point lost my beginning of round marker. Like it fell off. I didn't notice, I kept going. And it didn't really seem to be a problem because I was like, well, it doesn't really matter because I can tell where my beginning of round is, right? When I get to where it's one brown stitch on one side and one white stitch on the other side, right? Like that's fine. I have to pay a little bit more attention, but I was traveling. Like I said, I was in Pittsburgh for the weekend and I didn't have a stitch marker. So I was like, well, it's fine. I'll just pay more attention and keep knitting because my alternative is that I don't keep knitting. I mean, could I have found something else to use as a stitch marker? Absolutely. And spoiler, I did do that later once I realized the issue I was having, but I was like, it's fine, I'll just keep doing that. But the problem is that in an effort to disguise the jog in the stripes, Veronica recommends you do this thing where you're sort of creating like a, what do you call it, a double stitch? I don't think that's right, but just the idea of a longer stitch that covers two rows. And in doing that, it was messing with where it appeared that that color change happened by one stitch. So every time the color change happened, it just kept shifting sideways just a little bit. And then I realized, I was like, why is my beginning of round like at the edge of the underarm instead of centered under it? That was when I realized what I had done. So that was when I pulled a safety pin out of my getting ready kit that I had brought to be ready for this wedding that I was going to in Pittsburgh. And I started using that as a makeshift beginning of round marker and kind of forcibly returned the yarn back over to the center, and then it has been straight since then. But that was just kind of a funny issue that I had because what I had been relying on as my beginning of round indicator in the absence of a proper marker was a moving target. So whoops. Now, just last night I was knitting on this and I ran out of my first ball of the putty color, and my plan all along had been to knit this until I run out of the first ball, and then when I start the second ball, that will be when I go in and I do the I cord on the neck and on the underarms so that both I know that I have enough yarn to do that, and then I can just continue knitting the body until I'm close to running out. Also so that I can make sure that this fits properly, because again, I was a bit concerned about my row gauge. I don't want to knit the entire body of this only to find that the armhole is too small. It would be sad enough if that happened at this point, but it would be much worse if it happened once I knit many, many more inches. So I sat down last night to do the I cord on the neck. I thought it'd be really nice if I had that done for today for recording, for trying this on, but we had a little mayday situation. So the way that this pattern tells you to do the I cord is to first pick up your stitches all the way around the neck and then go in and do the I cord, which is a little bit different to how I have done an I cord before. I've only done it once before on my Tekla top, and on that one it's having you pick up and I cord sort of one stitch at a time as you work your way around the neck rather than picking them all up first. And I'm kind of two minds about this because if I could know that my pickups were perfect, I do think that would be a much nicer, more smoother experience where you get all your picking up done and then you can just I cord all the way along. But what in fact happened was that I did all of my pickups. I was following the direction in the pattern of the ratio of how many stitches per how many rows to pick up. And when I did that, at least to the best of my ability, maybe I didn't nail it, I ended up being a decent chunk off. I had fewer stitches picked up than the pattern recommends, even for the extra small, despite the fact that mine, you know, even though it's Frankenstein, that the neck should be accurate to a small. So I was short, like, I think about 15 or 20 stitches, which is not a small number, but I was thinking, okay, well, also the pattern tells me to size down on my needles to the eye cord, which I cannot do because I don't have those needles. Then again, I also knit tight, but sort of maybe the amalgamation of all these things will be that this is all sort of the right ratio. And I followed the ratio she recommended for how many stitches out of how many. So I'm just gonna start this eye cord. We're gonna see what happens. And sure enough, the eye cord started puckering the fabric pretty noticeably, suggesting that it really was cinching things in too much. And I did need to have picked up more stitches. So that was disappointing, both because of the time that I'd spent on the actual eye cord, but also because I had picked up all the way around the neck. And I hate picking up stitches. And now that was for nothing on the parts that I didn't get to eye cording. And I had to pull all that out, and I'm gonna have to pick up stitches again and try to increase my ratio and just try to figure out what is the correct amount. I'm kind of torn between, should I now try just doing pick up an eye cord as I go rather than picking up first, just so I can see if it's looking more like the right ratio before I've committed to picking them all up. But I'm also afraid that that might just cause issues that I don't currently understand that it will, as far as being different from what the pattern recommends, because I have so little experience with I-cord. So I'm feeling a little wary about next steps with the I-cord on this, but we're gonna figure it out. I'm not sure if the number of stitches in the pattern for the neckline would be the right one. Like, if I had just picked up to that exact number, would I have been fine? Or is it just that I work tightly enough that I need to pick up even more than that to compensate? So I don't really know. I think that the pattern indicated like an uneven ratio for everything except the very front, where it was a 1-for-1 pickup rate. And where I started, the eye cord was at the edge of the back here. So it was this part that was puckering. So I'm thinking that I might just try doing 1-for-1 all along the back also, because that would make sense to me, because you're picking up along this horizontal edge, and then just do her recommended ratio on like the vertical parts, like the straps, and see where that gets me. I don't know. There might be more trial and error yet before this looks right. So we shall see. Wish me luck. Now, I'm recording this on September 7th. So by the time this is finished, it's not gonna be the right weather to wear this in, at least on its own. But I am hopeful that this will still be able to serve me during more of this year as sort of a layering piece. And then at some point, like in the depths of winter, I will stow it away and then bring it out to surprise myself with in the spring when I've sort of half forgotten about it. And then we'll be really excited to be able to wear it. So I think that is the fate of this one. This is sort of the last hurrah of the summer knits that I'm trying to finish up so I can delve into some cozier, sort of lightweight fall transitional sweater knitting. But since I had already taken this off the needle so I could start that eye cord, it is on try-on tubing. Let's try this on and see where we're at. Ta-da! So it is a functional garment. It covers me. It is safe for work in that sense. Maybe not in the sense of the dress code of the average workplace. We're gonna have to ignore the many things dangling off of this, but it does work. It is a top. I'm planning to knit it further down so that it is more sort of tuckable slash compatible with more like mid-rise pants. But yeah, I feel like this is looking really good. Hopefully once there's I-cord on this underarm, it'll still be a good size. I've got some buffer space here that it could close up before it becomes much of an issue. Like, I think that if it were like this, it would start to get uncomfortable, but it's like 2 or 3 inches to spare. So hopefully we're fine on that, and my row gauge will not be an issue with the underarm hole. Fingers crossed. You know, I do definitely see with this on, the way that the negative ease is kind of showing some of the inconsistencies in the tension. So I'm hoping the blocking is going to even a little bit of that out, but that might also just be part of the nature of working with silk. And that's sort of a trade-off that you make in exchange for the lightness and the kind of cooling qualities of it. So TBD, we'll see how I feel about this when it's finished, how it ends up fitting into my wardrobe. But right now, mostly just like, look how cute and stripy it is. That's so fun. Like, just looking at this in my monitor from a distance, I'm like, wow, that's like a real striped top. Like, there's something to me about stripes. They just look so kind of perfect in this way that makes it feel less potentially handmade. Like, it's just like, oh, you made that? How? It's just cool. So yeah, this is my current progress on the Sailor Swift top. Okay, now let's get into acquisitions. So in my previous video, my fall knitting plans, I mentioned a yarn that I had ordered in planning to start my Colette pullover, but I didn't actually have yet, and it has arrived. So this is my beautiful yarn haul. Look at the color. Can we just admire this for a second? Look at it. It's the most perfect, like, citrine, chartreuse, pear, whatever you want to call it. It's perfect. So this is from The Wandering Flock, and this is their new base called Cotton Lino. So this is made out of 35% cotton, 30% mulberry silk, 20% linen, and 15% baby alpaca. So it's a real soup in there. There's a lot of different things going on, but it feels very soft. Like it, I feel like it feels more like an animal fiber than a plant-based fiber, despite the fact that it is majority plant-based. So I mean, to me, that's a very positive attribute. I think that plant-based fibers have a lot going for them, but their softness to the touch isn't always one of them. So I think that that's something really, really nice about this yarn. How is it for bounciness? Can I sort of test that without interrupting this too much? So I feel like it's kind of hard without like unwinding this. So don't take this as gospel, but I feel like it has a bit more bounce than you'd expect from a plant-based, but it's not as stretchy as like a wool would be. I think that that's kind of my tentative assessment of this. So this comes in 100 gram skeins and it's classified as a sport weight with 328 yards, and this is the color citrine. So like I said, I'm planning to knit with this the Colette pullover by Sari Nordland. This is something that I'm hoping to get to knit this fall. And what did this cost me? Oh yeah, so fun fact. So I ordered this from the Wandering Flock website and my order cost me $134 Canadian, which I was thrilled about because as it happened, I had just gotten a payment from my YouTube channel for $130. And I was like, oh my God, it paid for itself. I was really excited. Okay, Editing Alley popping in with Copper here to say, here I mentioned making money off the YouTube channel. I'm currently thinking that I will do a video once the channel reaches its 1 year anniversary, which will be at the end of January, talking about like the sort of finances of YouTube, like what the process was like to get monetized, what that actually means, like how much money has it actually brought in. And so if this is something that you have questions about, please let me know because I'd love to start collecting those questions so that I can think about including those in that video eventually. And then it came closer to the day of its arrival. And I got an email from UPS. We don't like getting emails from UPS because UPS told me that I owed $55 in taxes and handling fees. And you know, okay, like as a Canadian buying things from a US online store, I understand that this is a risk. I understand that this can happen and that's fine. I don't mind paying the tax on it. But what I do mind, my dearest UPS, is that those taxes amounted to $15. And the brokerage fee that they charged me to handle the collection of those taxes was $40. And that is how, my friends, we came to our grand total of $55 owed to UPS by me. And so this is how we went from this costing me $134 to costing me $189, which was not really what I was hoping for. This is a more expensive project now than I had planned for it to be. But that is what I get for ordering things shipped by UPS, apparently. So knowing that in the future, I might try to acquire the Wandering Flock if I'm gonna buy a Wandering Flock online from a Canadian vendor, but I don't think that I guess I didn't really investigate that thoroughly, but here's what happened. They announced that they had just posted their last batch of cotton lino for the year. And I had already determined that I wanted to knit this out of cotton lino and that I specifically wanted this specific color. And I saw that they put out their drop and I was like, ah, I better buy it before I can no longer buy it. And so I bought it and then UPS came for me. So $189 of yarn later, really looking forward to casting on my Colette pullover and hopefully really loving it because now it's more expensive than it was supposed to be. Also for reference, that $189 Canadian works out to be about $140 US. But absurd brokerage fees aside, it's really pretty. It's really soft. I love the color and I am very much looking forward to casting on with this and making my investment worth something. Okay, now it's time for Off the Needles, which is my segment where we talk about things that are not knitting, but sort of exist in this like creative, fun, hobby stuff kind of realm. So is that a finished book review today? No, I am in a book slump. I think we have to admit, I set down Lies and Weddings by Kevin Kwan to pick up Slow Dance by Rainbow Rowell, which I finished quite quickly, but after that, I have not picked up a book again. And I think I have to admit to myself that I'm just not in the correct reading spot for Lies and Weddings, which is a thing that I'm very bad at accepting because when it's a book that I know I will like, but it's just not the right time to be reading it, I have a hard time putting it down because it feels like I'm deciding that I'm never going to read it, and I don't want to never read it. I right now need books with, I think, less dense pages and shorter chapters. Like, I think that when I don't have a lot of reading momentum behind me, I really need more of that, like, popcorn reading kind of book, which Lies and Weddings is just not. Like, I've really enjoyed what I've read so far. I have loved Kevin's writing historically. I just think that I need more, like, undivided focused reading time to really be able to get into that book properly, and that's just not kind of the reading mode that I'm in right now. So I think I kind of just need to accept that, shelve it for a bit, and delve into something a little shorter, choppier, faster paced. So I don't know, that might mean diving into the new Casey McQuiston book, The Pairing, that I showed in my last video. It might also be my new acquisition. So this one is another pre-order and it just arrived yesterday. This is Everything We Never Had by Randy Ribbe. And so Randy is an author who I have read before. His previous book, Patron Saints of Nothing, is a book that I absolutely loved. Like, I think I read it in 2020. I remember reading it kind of actively peak COVID lockdown sort of situation, so I'm not sure if that was 2020 or if that would have been one of the later ones in 2021. But that book just like seared itself into my brain. I think it's actually, is it one of my front facing books over here? Yes, it's over there. Doesn't look like I'm pointing to it. It's because on my monitor it's hidden behind the record button, so it is over there roughly. But so I really, really love that book. And I mean, in typical Allie fashion, can I remember a lot specifically about the book to tell you? No. So I think that in that book, the main character is Filipino American, and something happens to his cousin who I believe was living in the Philippines. And then he like goes to the Philippines to try to figure out what happened to his cousin. If that's not what happens, editing me will pop in to correct me. I just remember it painting such a vivid picture of both the main character, but also his family and the influence of their Filipino culture and also his American upbringing. And just all of this in a story where I felt so deeply invested in the outcomes for these characters. It's also, I believe it's a YA book, and it felt to me like it had sort of a gravitas, I'm gonna use what's gonna feel like an excessively fancy word, but I don't know, it just to me had like a weight and a staying power that to me like the best YA has. To me, Painter Stains of Nothing was like absolute top tier, like this is what YA can do, and it makes me so frustrated when people underestimate it as a genre, because reading that book was an amazing time in terms of being invested in the plot, in terms of caring so much about those characters. I also learned a ton about Filipino culture without in any way feeling like it was didactic or like I was being condescended to or having my hand held. It was more just through an immersion into this character's life, and it was just so incredibly well written. So I am really, really excited to dive into Everything We Never Had. So this book, I'll just read the quick little blurb. The McGobble family journey begins with 16-year-old Francisco, who has left everything behind in the Philippines to seek his fortune in California. Following this life-changing decision, each generation of McGobble boys must forge a path forward while contending with the past. And then the rest of the blurb kind of outlines these four different timelines in the 30s, the 60s, the 80s, and in 2020. So it looks like we're going to be following a multi-generational family story within quite a short, this book is like maybe 250 pages long. It's not long, it's not tightly typeset. So I'm really curious to see how he does this, because Copper's also curious. Do you want it? Oh, and he's gonna itch himself. It's Copper's peak allergy season right now, so we're a little bit itchy, but we're less itchy than in previous years, which means that our expensive immunotherapy is working. So I'm really curious to see how he's gonna do this in this small of a package, but Randy has my trust, so I am really looking forward to this one. I'm also in this segment today going to talk about a couple of fun things that I went to see in Pittsburgh that feel very related to the kind of spirit of this segment. So the first is that I got to go to the Andy Warhol Museum, which despite the fact that I've definitely had to study Andy Warhol in school, I didn't know, or at least didn't remember knowing, that Andy Warhol is from Pittsburgh. So they have this whole museum there all dedicated to him, and it's so well done. It's such a good time. Highly recommend if you're in Pittsburgh. So I got to visit some of the famous Campbell's soup cans that I've definitely had to read about in so many textbooks, as well as so much of his other work. The museum does a really fantastic job of tracing kind of his entire life and career. And it was just really cool to be in the presence of something that has loomed so large, and particularly as a graphic designer. So I've had to study art history in school, but then also more specifically graphic design history, and Andy Warhol kind of sits at the intersection of those two things as an artist slash commercial artist who sometimes was creating works about products, as in the Campbell soup cans, but also sometimes was making art for products, as in window displays at department stores. So he really kind of sits in the middle of this world. But what I love so much about Andy Warhol is his complete rejection of the sort of highbrow, lowbrow division in art. And I think that as knitters, this is something that also applies to us. You know, there's a lot of overlap between that idea and the division between what is art and what is craft, and the way that crafts like knitting can be sort of denigrated in comparison to fine art like painting. And I just kind of think that's all trash. Like, I kind of just like, what do we care? Like, let people make things. Like, I don't really see value in being like, this one is more important than this one. You know, at OCAD, when I was doing my degree in graphic design, there was a similar question that would pop up all the time. We'd be debating this question of like, what is art versus what is design? And I just like quite simply don't care. I think like, make stuff, make something that has something to say. If you have something to say, make something that just is pretty and makes you feel happy. If that's what you want to make. Like, I don't care. I love that Andy Warhol also didn't care. Like, there was a piece in this collection where he had just done a giant piece that looked like a paint by number, just to be like, why is the paint by number not art? Like, why does this get to be art, but this doesn't get to be art? Like, you have picked up a paintbrush and you have spent that time and you have created this thing as much as anyone else created something. And like, for me, I think part of why I simply don't care is just, to me, it's like the joy is in the making of the thing and in the then kind of transfer of that joy and creativity and excitement of the person who made it that then gets like sent over to the person looking at it. You know, I think there's an important place in the world for art that challenges and pushes boundaries and discusses hard topics. And I equally think there's a place in the world for art that just makes us happy while we're contending with all the junk in the world that makes this kind of art also necessary. Like, I think we need both. And I'm so disinterested in arguments that put this above this. And it seems like that's kind of also how Andy Warhol felt. And I really appreciate him for that. So I had a really fun time at the museum and I realized while I was there, I was walking around the gallery looking at all the stuff, and a lot of his work is screen prints. He worked in editions, so there are multiples of a lot of his pieces. And specifically, I would say the majority of the pieces were screen prints on linen. Now, I felt very at home there because I realized that the jumpsuit that I was wearing, which, shout out Maker and Mineral, tiny little one-person artisan shop who made this jumpsuit, it is also made of screen-printed linen. And I was like, I feel like I belong in this gallery right now. So that was a fun bonus. The other fun artsy thing that I went to do in Pittsburgh was to go see Falling Water, which is a house that was designed by the famous architect Frank Lloyd Wright, who again is a name that I have heard so many times in design school. And I always sort of, in theory, appreciated his work. I really love a sort of modern, organic, mid-century design style. And this is my first time actually getting to see one of his designs in person. So this is a summer house for obviously an incredibly wealthy family. They owned a department store in the 50s, so obviously life was good for department store owners in the 50s. And the house is literally built into this waterfall. Like, pieces of the foundation of the house cradle giant boulders that are like part of this waterfall. So it's absolutely stunning. It's also highly impractical. We learned that they spend like $1 million every single year fixing leaks in the house because the material that it's made out of is too porous. So this is one of those things that I find really hilarious about these sort of well-known fancy architects, is like, so many things are justified down to the tiniest detail of how it made perfect sense because of this consideration and that consideration. It's like everything is so thought through to the most minute detail, except for the very basic things like, what material should we build this house out of so that water doesn't get in? Like, okay. It just feels like a very designery thing to me, honestly. I mean, this is one of the things that you sort of have to try to unlearn as a designer. I think generally people get into design because they have a strong sense of aesthetics, and sometimes aesthetics bump up against function. And part of the challenge of being a designer is reconciling that collision logically, because I'll admit, we often just want to do the thing that looks the nicest. And it can be really, really hard to make the decision of what is actually going to work better, but maybe not look quite as nice. And I just felt like the more I learned about this house, the more I saw that at play. And I was like, oh, this is a very familiar feeling to me. But so outside of the house, obviously very impressive, but I also was so in love with the inside of the house and the decor there. It's just, it's so mid-century. There's so many built-ins. Everything is so purposeful. I was obsessed with the way that there was this boiling pot for the fire that could be swung out of the way so that you just had this nice interrupted fireplace, but then the pot had like a little like a divot in the wall where it fits into. So like this is what I mean with like things being considered down to the most minor detail until it's like something major. But like that's the kind of detail where I'm like, oh my god, it's beautiful. They were also telling us about how this house just has a million windows, right? This is also how you know that this was a rich family, because no one who had to clean their own windows would be having this many windows, particularly with this many like divider lines that like make it hard to clean the windows. But our guide was telling us about how Frank Lloyd Wright basically finished the house and there were no screens in the windows. And the family was like, okay, but can we get some screens in the windows? And he was like, no, that would ruin the effect. And the family was like, okay, but this is a summer in Pennsylvania. Like, there are a lot of bugs. And they ended up having to get like third-party aftermarket screens installed because Frank Lloyd Wright was just like, no. And just, as a designer, it sounds like something a designer would do. All right, so that's it. That's all I've got for you today. Thank you so much for coming to knit with me. If you'd like to be here next time, I hope you'll consider subscribing. If you're not, if you already are, you're my favorite, and I'll see you next time.